Sunday after Easter. We're glad you could all join us this morning, and we welcome all of you joining by video, by online this morning. Welcome. We're glad to have you here with us. Hope you'll join right in and worship along with us today. A couple of announcements. Today, there will be the funeral for Bud Reinhardt. And so after church today, there's going to be a dinner, and the food is over in the fellowship hall. We invite all of you to participate in that, and that will be followed by the funeral service this afternoon. Additionally, next week, a week from today, is May 1st, and it is our homecoming here at Heiberger United Methodist Church. So I hope you all can join us for that. We have a special worship time. There will be no Sunday school next week, but we will have worship at 11, not 10, but 11, next Sunday only. And then after that, we will have our special meal in the fellowship hall to celebrate homecoming. And then Monday night, Tuesday night, and Wednesday night, May 2nd, 3rd, and 4th, here at Heiberger at 7 o'clock p.m., we will have our revival service. And I'm so excited about that because we haven't been able to do it for a couple of years because of coronavirus, but thank God we're able to do it this year. So please make plans to join us those three nights. It's going to be a special time, and I'm looking forward to preaching on those nights, and I hope you will be here with us as well. Are there any other announcements we need to make this morning? Well, I'm glad you're all here. I'm glad you're all joining us. If you would turn in your hymn book to our responsive call to worship, it's on page 819, 819. And if you will stand as you're able, and let's begin our worship time together this morning. This is Psalm 99, page 819. The Lord reigns, let the people tremble. The Lord sits enthroned upon the cherubim. Let the earth quake.
The Lord is great in Zion, and is exalted over all the peoples.
Let them praise your great and wondrous name.
Holy is the Lord.
Mighty ruler, lover of justice, you have established equity.
You have executed justice and righteousness in Jacob.
Extol the Lord our God, worship at the Lord's footstool.
Holy is the Lord.
Moses and Aaron were among God's priests. Samuel also was among those who called on God's name.
They cried to the Lord who answered them, who spoke to them in the pillar of clouds.
They kept God's testimonies and the statutes God gave them.
O Lord, our God, you answered them. You were a forgiving God to them.
Extol the Lord our God and worship at his holy mountain.
Surely the Lord our God is holy.
And now number 64, holy, holy, holy.
Song shall rise to thee.
expressing our statement of faith. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead, he ascended into heaven, and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. And you can be seated. And now our church enters into a time of prayer. Do you have requests that you would like to mention to the church this morning? Remember the Reinhardt family.
I'm having another test on Friday.
Okay. Thank God for my cataract surgery. Wednesday went well, and I'm so happy with the results. Thanks for your prayers. Tommy's going in for knee replacement surgery on May the 12th. So let's remember to pray for Tommy. Anything else?
Like my mother, she's continuously kind of going down a little continuously, week by week, looks like.
Okay, would you take some private time, silent time, to take your prayers to the Lord, and after a few moments, I'll lead us. Lord, this is the day that you have made, and we will rejoice and be glad in it. Thank you so much for what a beautiful day this is. Lord, thank you for my renewed sight and being able to see things so much more clearly, and I give you praise and honor. Thanks for that. Thank you for medical professionals and all the work they do on our behalf. And God, we do come before you this morning with thanksgiving and enter your courts with praise, and we are thankful. And even so, Lord, as we bow in prayer together as a congregation, we're mindful of those in our midst who are grieving. We pray for the Reinhardt family, the loss of Bud, a treasured member of this church, a part of this church for many, many, many years, and precious family. And we lift them up to you today, Lord, as they honor his memory with his memorial service. And God, today we lift up those that are facing medical procedures. We pray for Brenda and for Tommy. Pray for Tommy's mother. And Lord, as we come before you, we also want to come on behalf of the world. God, our prayers, our fervent prayers, heartfelt prayers, with the prayers of people around the world, or for Ukraine, and God, for there to be a just end to this war. God, it breaks our hearts. I know it breaks yours. So be with those brave soldiers and military people and civilians and people facing hardship and displacement. Bless those countries around that are receiving refugees. But God, we do pray for a merciful end to this war. And God, today we do pray for your churches around the world that are, some of them are celebrating Orthodox Easter on this Sunday today, and others like us are celebrating the first Sunday after Easter and remembering your words to your disciples on that Sunday night. So God bless our worship today. We pray that we could truly worship with our whole hearts, with our spirit, and in truth. And God, that because of this encounter and worship with the living Christ, that we will be changed. And God, bless your church gathered for worship today. In Jesus Christ's name we pray. Amen. And let's pray the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. And now if you'll turn in your hymn book to 378, you might not even need it. We're going to sing Amazing Grace. Would you stand as you're able? 378. Chapter 20. This is the fourth week in a row we've been in John 20. We'll finish it up today. We're looking at John 20, verses 19 to 31. John 20, 19 to 31. On the evening of that first day of the week, when the disciples were together, with the doors locked for fear of the Jewish leaders, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." After he said this, he showed them his hands and side. The disciples were overjoyed when they saw the Lord. Again, Jesus said, "Peace be with you, and as the Father has sent me, I am sending you." And with that, he breathed on them and said, "Receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive anyone's sins, their sins are forgiven, and if you do not forgive them, they are not forgiven." Now Thomas, also known as Didymus, one of the 12, was not with the disciples when Jesus came. So the other disciples told him, "We have seen the Lord." But he said to them, "Unless I see the nail marks in his hands, and put my finger where the nails were, and put my hand into his side, I will not believe." A week later, his disciples were in the house again, and Thomas was with them. Though the doors were locked, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." Then he said to Thomas, "Put your finger here. See my hands. Reach out your hand and put it into my side. Stop doubting and believe." Thomas said to him, "My Lord and my God." Then Jesus told him, "Because you have seen me, you have believed. Blessed are those who have not seen and yet have believed." This is the word of the Lord.
Glory be to the Father.
Let's pray. And God, now we want to pray for this offering. Thank you, Lord, for the capacity to give, because you have blessed us so richly. And now, Lord, as an act of worship, we give you our tithes and offerings, because God, we want to be a vital part of what you're doing in our world to bring about healing and restoration and forgiveness and salvation. So thank you, Lord, for calling us and empowering us, commissioning us to do your work. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Today, as I said, is the first Sunday after Easter. And so we, along with churches around the whole world, are looking at this passage of Scripture, which takes place on the first week after Easter, part of it on the Sunday night of Easter itself, and then part of it the following week. But if you notice, the beginning of this is taking place on the evening of Easter Sunday, Resurrection Day, the day Jesus rose from the dead. So it says, on the evening of that first day of the week, when the disciples were together, with the doors locked for fear of the Jewish leaders, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." After he said this, he showed them his hands and side. The disciples were overjoyed when they saw the Lord. This is Resurrection Day, the first Sunday. I think this was the first Sunday evening worship service. You remember Sunday evening worship services? We all used to have Sunday evening worship services. Well, this was kind of the initiation of that, I suppose. When I read this and studied this, my thought was, well, this is the evening of Resurrection Day. We know what happened that morning when Jesus rose from the dead, but where was Jesus all the rest of that day? Where was Jesus all afternoon? We have no mention of where he was. So I have a theory. Now I want you to know this is Mike Lewis's theory. I didn't read this in any books. I didn't learn it in seminary. I have never heard anybody teach this. This is my theory, but I think I can back it up with scripture. I think Jesus that afternoon took a nap. I really do. Let me tell you why. Jesus had just been through the most grueling 4 days imaginable. To say that it was an intense week is an understatement, right? Remember, Thursday night was Gethsemane. My goodness, Gethsemane. It tells us in another gospel, they went to a place called Gethsemane, and Jesus said to his disciples, "Sit here while I pray." And he took with him Peter and James and John and began to be greatly distressed and troubled. This is Jesus, greatly distressed and troubled. And he said to Peter, James, and John, "My soul is sorrowful even to death." That's how sorrowful Jesus was on Thursday night. And I can understand that, can't you? He knew what was coming. Man, I get scared when I'm about to face something. You know, the night before my open heart surgery, I was full of anticipation. I don't know what the word is, but I knew something was coming that was going to be grueling and hard. But Jesus knew what was coming. And he said, "My soul is very sorrowful, even to death. Remain here and watch." And going a little further, he fell on the ground and prayed, "If it were possible, the hour might pass from him." And he said, "Abba, Father, all things are possible for you. Remove this cup from me. Yet not what I will, but what you will." And he came and found them sleeping. And he said to Peter, Simon, are you asleep? Could you not watch 1 hour? Watch and pray that you may not enter temptation. The spirit is willing, but the flesh is weak. Jesus was willing to go through with crucifixion on the cross. That was his mission. He understood it. But he also understood that even though his spirit was willing, the flesh is weak. His flesh was about to go through something. And then on Friday, he was crucified. Before he was crucified, he was whipped, remember? 39 lashes? That would almost kill a person. They jammed a crown of thorns on his head. They mocked him. He had to carry his cross down the Via Dolorosa. He fell a bunch of times along the way. Then they nailed him to the cross. And he hung there for hours until he died. So now it's Sunday. Jesus rose from the dead early that morning. And he has his disciples to be concerned about. He appears to Mary. And he lets Mary touch him. And he tells her after she touches him to go and tell the others that he will meet them in Galilee. And then he's not mentioned again until that evening. So my theory is that Jesus went somewhere and found a place where he could rest. I think the evidence is in the Bible. In Mark 6, it says, "The apostles returned to Jesus from their ministry tour and told him all they had done and taught. Then Jesus said, 'Let's go off by ourselves to a quiet place and rest a while.'" He said this because there were so many people coming and going that Jesus and his apostles didn't even have time to eat. That was Jesus. "Let's go off by ourselves to a quiet place and rest a while." We all know the 23rd Psalm. He leads me beside the green pastures. He lets me rest in green pastures. He leads me beside the still waters. He restores my soul. I believe Jesus went and found him a place where he could be alone and be quiet and rest. There's a saying from the old poem Desiderata. It says, many fears are born of fatigue and loneliness. And I think about that sometimes when I'm fearful. I think, why are you feeling this way, Mike? A lot of times it is because I'm just worn out. I'm lonely. I think that's what those disciples were experiencing that night. They were fearful. They were in that place together. But man, they had been through a weekend also. They'd been through it. They had seen their Lord crucified, dead, and buried. They had seen people kill Jesus, and now they were wondering if they were going to kill them too. Man, my heart goes out to those disciples. They've been through a rough and confusing few days. They were understandably afraid of what might happen to them. And then Jesus showed up. You know why Jesus showed up there? He cared about those disciples. He loved them. He knew they'd been through, he'd been through a lot, but he knew they'd been through a lot too. Jesus was concerned about them. If you're a general and your troops have just been through a bloody battle, you're concerned about your troops. You want to go. You want to speak to them. You want to encourage them to get rest, and you want to tell them. If you're a coach and your team has just been through a hard game, then you want to go to them. You want to speak to them. Well, all the more so, Jesus wanted to be with his disciples. So he went there and he stood among them, and the first thing he said, think how important that is. This is the first thing he said to them. He said, peace be with you. Peace. He spoke peace. Peace be with you. In Hawaii, you know, there's a word aloha that means both hello and goodbye. Well, in Israel, the phrase they use both for hello and goodbye is peace be with you. They say it upon greeting one another, and they say it upon leaving one another. Peace be with you. That's what Jesus said to them. And then after he said this, he showed them his hands and his side, and the disciples were overjoyed when they saw the Lord. You know, when Jesus said, peace be with you, sometimes people, when they think what peace means is like just the absence of conflict, you know. But peace is such a rich, biblical, theological Jesus term, because peace, as you know, is shalom. Shalom means everything is put back right. Shalom means things are fixed. It literally means nothing missing, nothing broken. Jesus comes and says, peace be with you. And he wanted them to experience that peace because of him, what he'd been through. He showed them his hands and his side, and the disciples were overjoyed. So did you get that? Initially, they were afraid, but now Jesus comes in their midst. He speaks peace to them. He shows them his hands and side, and now they're overjoyed. Have you ever been to church? Maybe you came to church with a heavy heart. Maybe you came to church disappointed, frustrated, angry, fearful, grieving, sad, afraid. But because you were in the presence of the living God in worship, and by the way, we are, aren't we? Where two or more are gathered in his name, he's there in their midst. Christ is here. So when you come and you have a real experience of worship, you hear the word of the Lord, you hear the Holy Spirit speaking to your heart, And you respond to that by trusting in him, allowing him to heal you, to forgive you, to cleanse you, to restore you. Then you leave that same worship service overjoyed. I've had that experience so many times. I know you have too. So Jesus loves these people. These are his disciples. And he reassures them in the midst of certain and real fear that they ought to be at peace. Peace be unto you. You know, earlier in this Gospel of John, in chapter 14, Jesus said, "Peace I leave with you, my peace I give to you. Not as the world gives, do I give to you. Let not your hearts be troubled, neither let them be afraid." Jesus gives peace unlike any other peace. It's like no other peace that can be experienced in the world. It's a peace that passes understanding. And because of the peace that Christ offers us, our hearts are not to be troubled or afraid. And Jesus reiterates that. Jesus reinforces that. Jesus reminds them of that. Jesus reassures them of that at this teaching right after his resurrection. And then in John 16, Jesus said, "I have said these things to you, that in me you may have peace. In the world you will have tribulation, but take heart, I have overcome the world." So yes, the Bible and Jesus acknowledge that in the world there's always tribulations. Today, as we gather, there's still people getting sick with coronavirus, worrying about that. There's still war in Ukraine. There's still conflicts around the world. There's still personal issues we're facing. Many of them are huge and heavy. So there's tribulation, but take courage. I have overcome the world. So Jesus promises peace even in the midst of tribulation because of who he is and what he's done for us. So now Jesus meets with his disciples. That evening, Jesus is resurrected. His first words are, "Peace be with you." And those are the first words he utters. They're the culmination of his previous teachings, but they're filled with new meaning because of his death, burial, and resurrection. And their fear turns to joy. Wow. Jesus is taking care of his disciples after the toughest weekend. And then he does something else. He breathes on them and gives them the Holy Spirit, and he commissions them to go and carry out his mission. He's now entrusting them with the very mission that he had by coming to earth, which is to seek and to save the lost. But he breathed on them. That's significant. Breath. You're breathing right now. Inhale and exhale. In the Bible, the word that's used for God is an unpronounceable word. It's in English letters, it's YHWH. And did you know that's really not a name, but it's a breath. Now, as time passed, religion, as religion is prone to do, priests began to say that that name was too holy to speak. So they wouldn't say anything about that. Later on, some people tried to add in some vowels to make it pronounceable, so they started calling it Yahweh, or then Jehovah. Y'all have all heard the name Jehovah. Well, that's people putting vowels in to try to make it pronounceable. It's really not what the Bible says is God's name, because God's name is not really a name. It's a breath. the sound of inhaling and the sound of exhaling. God's name is simply the name of breathing. Breath is all throughout the scriptures. When God created humans out of the dust of the earth, you remember what he did? He breathed into them the nefesh hayah, the breath of life, the breath of God, and humans became living beings. As long as we have life, we have breath. So the very act of breathing is an acknowledgement that you're alive, that you're a creature of God, that his breath is in your lungs. That's what life is. That's how close God is to you. We're God creatures. So Jesus is reminding them of all that. He breathes on them. Breathes on them. And fills them with the Holy Spirit. And commissions them to go. Now Thomas, now he's one of the disciples for sure. But for some reason, he wasn't there that first Sunday night. He was not with the disciples when Jesus came that first time. So they went to Thomas and said, "Hey, Thomas, we've seen the Lord." And you know what Thomas said? "Well, good for you. But unless I see him with my own eyes, I put my hands in his nail marks, and I put my finger where the nails were, and I put my hand in his side, unless that happens, I'm not going to believe." So then the next Sunday night, the week after Jesus' resurrection, when the disciples were in the house again, this time Thomas was there. So remember, Jesus loves these people. Thomas is important to Jesus, just like they all are. He loves them. These are his disciples. So again, for Thomas's benefit, like he did the week before, he says, even though the doors were locked, he came in. By the way, Jesus is the door, right? That's what he said. So Jesus came and he stood among them and he said, "Peace be with you," just like he did the week before. Then he said to Thomas this time. Last week he said it to all the disciples. This time he says it to Thomas. "Put your hand, you don't touch my nail marks. Put your hand on my side, Thomas. Go ahead." He didn't chide Thomas for missing it the first time. He simply repeated it for Thomas. And he said to Thomas, "Stop doubting and believe." And you know what Thomas said in response? Thomas said probably the most important statement in all of Scripture. This is it. He said, "My Lord and my God." My Lord and my God. Thomas was making a statement of relationship. My Lord. And he was saying that his Lord is God. Can you imagine? That would have been blasphemous to Thomas and these other disciples not too long ago. But now he's acknowledging that Christ is his Lord and his God. This is about personal relationship. It's about knowing that the Lord is your Lord. I had a little boy in my church, and his parents were two of my most active members. His dad was a deacon, my head deacon actually, and his mother was sang in the choir. They were always at church. So little Nathaniel had known me since he was just a little infant. By now he was probably two and a half, and he had a problem with his hip joint. So they made him wear braces that held his legs out like he was riding on a horse. And he had to wear those braces and walk around in them. And it was so cute. He was a cute kid. They squeaked every time he walked, you know. He got around. He went everywhere with those braces on. But there came a time when he needed to go to Boston to the doctored to be checked, and they were going to have a gathering of all the doctors because they were studying his case. But his mother and his father couldn't go. They both were important in their work and had things going on at that particular day. So they asked me if I would take Nathaniel to Boston to his appointment. And I, of course, agreed to do so. So I drove little Nathaniel up to Boston and took him in the hospital, and they got him all ready. And they were ready to take him back into this room where all these doctors in their white coats were going to be with little Nathaniel. And they went off. I said goodbye to him. And in a few minutes, one of the doctors came out and he said, "You're his pastor, right?" And I said, "Yes, sir." And he said, "You need to come on and be with us." So Nathaniel had gotten frightened, you know, with all those doctors and being 2 years old, and they were examining him. So I went in and I was there with him, and he did fine. He was very brave, you know, as they examined him. And then they put him in a room for further observation. They were going to keep him overnight. But after his parents got off work, they drove to Boston. They came to the hospital. And so I was in the room. In walks Joe and Grace, his parents. And I wish you could have seen little Nathaniel. He was so happy to see his mother and dad. And they went on either side of the bed, and they bent over, and he was hugging them and kissing them and going, "My mommy, my daddy, my mommy, my daddy." And Joe said, "Hey, come on, Pastor Mike, you can join in this." And I said, no, he needs this time with y'all. You know, he's so excited about his parents being there. And when I read this about Thomas, I thought of that. It's like Thomas is saying, "My Lord, my God, he's alive, he's with us, he's resurrected." And then Jesus said to Thomas, "Because you have seen me, you have seen me, you have believed. Blessed are those who have not seen and yet believed." That's us, isn't it? I wasn't there with Jesus the night after his resurrection or the week after his resurrection. I wasn't there for those 40 days while he was still appearing to people on earth. Neither were you. So this is written for us. Blessed are those who have not seen and yet believed. But you know what we did see? You know what we did hear? Those disciples did what Jesus commissioned them to do. They went and told others. They proclaimed the gospel of Christ. And those people believed, and then they passed it on to others. And that went on down through the ages for over 2,000 years until finally somebody proclaimed the gospel to me. And I believed, and now I'm trying to proclaim that gospel and share it with other people, and so are you. So blessed are those who have not seen and yet believed. You know what that means? It means you are blessed. I'm blessed. And then it says, Jesus performed many other signs in the presence of his disciples. I told you he was concerned about them. He wanted them to be encouraged and empowered, and he kept performing many other signs in their presence that are not recorded in this book. Boy, I wish they were recorded in this book. But these are written, why? That you may believe that Jesus is the Messiah, the Son of God, and that by believing, you may have life in his name. This is for you. That's why the Gospel of John was written down. It was for you. Now, I don't know where you are in your faith journey this morning. I don't know if you're hearing all this for the first time. You've never really considered the claims of Christ in the Bible before, though this is for you. Or maybe you've heard this before, maybe you've been in church a lot, but you still have never come to the place where you believed it and received it and trusted in Christ for salvation. Well, this is for you. Or maybe you have heard it. Maybe you've got disillusioned somewhere along the way and drifted away. Maybe you need to be reinstilled, encouraged. Well, this is for you. That's why this was written. So this gospel, this story is written for you. Now, this is where we're going to end in our study of John 20 and the gospel. We know what happens after this, after Jesus appeared for 40 days. The Bible says he ascended into heaven. And as we say in the Apostles' Creed every Sunday, he sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. And we know that Jesus is coming again, don't we? Just as sure as he died on the cross, was buried, and was resurrected and ascended, he is coming again. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. So here we are, another gathering of Christ's disciples on a Sunday. You heard Christ's words of encouragement. Peace be with you. Know that Christ breathes on you and commissions you to go and tell the good news. So today, after church, there's going to be, like I said, a lunch and then a funeral service for a beloved church member. But you know what you should do after that? Go home, take a nap, rest, breathe, and then go and tell what you have seen and heard and experienced so others can share in your joy. Would you pray with me? Lord, we too have been through a lot. We still are going through things. And you care about us. You understand. And your desire is for us to be restored and renewed, and for our fear to be turned to joy. So God, thank you that you love us just as much as you loved your disciples, just as much as you loved Thomas, and that you come to us today quietly in worship, because you are here to breathe life into us anew and to recommission us to go in the power of the Spirit to share what we've seen and heard so that others can experience this joy as well. Thank you, Lord. Thank you. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Now, if you'll turn to number 395, let's stand and sing our closing hymn. 395, Take Time to Be Holy. Confident in you and empowered by your Spirit to be your people and your witnesses in this world through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Go in peace.